welcome you all. Good afternoon or good evening to you all, I don't know. Which one is it? In terms of F9, name of the subject, that's where we have to start, no? Name of the subject, what's it? And guys, can you see the board? Is it clear? Okay. So, F9 starts with something called financial management. Yes or no? Good. What is F5? That is out of the syllabus, is it? Okay. So, in terms of F9, guys, in terms of financial management, it's going to be a very small syllabus. But you need to understand the key. Financial management is like making money with money. Or else, how to employ your money to make profits. What is F5? I think Vidya, Charan, you've done F5, is it? No, okay. F5, like, you know, guys, it's performance management, right? It's all about managing your performance. It's all about, you know, what techniques in management you need to do. What is it? Okay, so it's okay. I'm just referring to the subject so I can go here. It's fine. So I'm just telling it what it means. So in terms of F5, guys, it was always about this management techniques, right? How to improve profits, what technique you should follow to, you know, maximize your profits and all those thinking skills. But here in financial management, what happens is, comparatively, this is how you have to understand it. How do you actually manage to employ your resources to make profits? Okay. How do you make money with money? Where do you put your money? Where do you invest? Simply, how do you manage your finances? That's all. But with regard to financial management, guys, it's always this, the entire syllabus is crunched to three different areas. It's three different areas. Now, have you heard this term investment? Everyone is talking about investment, right? Have you heard this term investment? One key aspect of, guys, if you can just off the mic for just 5 minutes. It's giving you a kind of irritation. Just 5 minutes, okay? So if you have a question, just ask. So I'll finish this, you can ask. So in terms of financial management, you've heard of this term investment. It's a big thing in financial management, investing. Where to invest? If so, how to invest, right? If I invest here, how much of profits do I get? So all these things are investing related things. So in talking about financial management, it's all about where do you put your money to get the best? How do you manage your finances? So in terms of managing finances, the F9 syllabus will broadly be split into three areas. First one is called an investment decision. Right? It's called an investment decision. Now to invest, you need money. Yes or no? To invest, you need money. So you have to, maybe you have the cash, maybe you have to borrow from outside. Maybe you can take a loan, maybe you can issue shares. There are so many options to drag your finances. Yes or no? So if you have an investment decision, the next thing that you will be looking forward is for a financing decision. Are we okay? So get it, guys. So what is financial management? You can on your mics. So what is financial management? Just get the tone of the subject. Financial management is all about, you know, managing your finances or making money with the resources you have. How do you do that? The first decision that comes into, or the first idea that comes into mind in managing your finances or financial management is investing. So in financial management, there's a large area of the syllabus that talks about investing decisions. Where to invest. But you know, if you have to invest, you need the finance. You might have the cash, you might have to borrow. That borrowing might come in the form of shares, that borrowing might come in the form of loans, anything. You have to take a decision. And that's referred to as the financing decision or the financing decision, right? But then, if you took the correct financing decision, if you invested in the correct place, do you still think everything will work fine or there's some kind of risk? Guys, you arranged the finances, everything was fine, you invested in a proper place also. But if the investment is taking like 5, 6, 10, 12 years to go on, do you think it's going to be smooth or will you face risk? You will face risk. Now, in order to do a proper financial management, it's not always only about the financing decision and the investing decision. You need to also know how to manage risk, or it's called risk management. So your financial management is broadly three areas, right? Investing decisions, to invest you need finance, so financing decisions. Even if you have the proper finance and the proper investment, still you're subject to risk, which means you need to know how to manage risk. So at F9, in terms of financial management, the syllabus is talking about these three areas, right? How do you take a decision with regard to investment? How do you take a decision with regard to finance? How do you manage your risks? Is this clear? And I'm telling you right now, on the day of the exam, you will face a 20 mark question for sure on a place called investment appraisal. Heard of this term, net present value, NPV? Somewhere down the line, heard of something called net present value? I'm telling you today, a 20 mark, for sure. For sure, there's no doubt about it. You're going to have a question on net present value, for sure. Okay, that's how predictable the subject is. But with F5, you can't do that. You know better than me, right? But right now, the syllabus is also very easy. Financial management is all about these three decisions. And below these three decisions come your syllabus areas. What you should study under investing decisions, what you should study under financing, and what you should be studying under risk management. So slowly we'll be covering each. But again, the approach remains the same. No writing 500 pages of notes. No writing 300 pages of memorizing notes. Nothing doing. Each and every decision or each and every part of the syllabus, we'll look at exam questions, understand the concept, apply, go ahead. Is that clear? And Vidya, be very free with it. If you have a question, if you're not understanding, 1,000 times you can ask it, there's no issue. We won't go forward unless you finish it. Right? Don't care about anyone. No one is going to judge you for anything. If there is a problem, stop and just, you know, make sure that's over. Don't go ahead, because I'll tell you why. It's a very manageable subject, but if you carry a doubt, it'll just multiply like each and every time when you're doing a new concept, because everything is interrelated. So clear it off and go ahead. But before that, let me ask you guys, is this syllabus mapping okay with you? Very simple. Three areas you have to focus on, right? We are doing the first area today. We are doing ID today, right? We are doing the 20 marks today. That's it. But then you need to understand your financial management, or managing your finances and making money with the resources you have, is largely dependent on these three decisions. How well you're in your investing decisions, how well can you gather your finances, and how well you take care of your risks. And in between these two, there are two more areas of the syllabus which I'll try to tell you. Can you go to that tute which says F9 start? It's having the map. Correct? Do you leave part C and leave part F? But do you see, investment decision is linked to business finance is linked to risk management. This is your entire syllabus map, but now I'll tell you what working capital management is. Have you heard of the term working capital? At minimum, have you heard this? Day-to-day activities. When I'm saying investment appraisal, I'm talking about investing decisions long term, 5, 10, 15 years. But for you to go 5, 10, 15 years, every day matters, yes or no? Which means it's not about you talking about large investment decisions or investment appraisal. It's about taking care of the day-to-day activities, which is covered in working capital management. Are we okay? So, as a part of investing decisions, you have working capital management also. But then, let me tell you this, right? Let me tell you this. As a company, if you took proper investing decisions and if you arranged the finances, that is, financing decisions were also arranged perfectly, if you manage the risk perfectly, what's the next move? What do you try to do next with your company? if you were a startup and if you were a company who took proper investing decisions, gathered the proper finance, managed your risks properly, what's your next step? Let's go public, yes or no? Let's go public and see what this thing is happening, right? You know all the companies, right? Amazon started as, you know, selling books at the garage. But then after having proper investing decisions, arranging the proper, I won't say arranging the proper finance, but somewhat, then being able to manage and map the risks properly, the next level of growth is going public, yes or no? But if you want to go public, you can't just do it. You need to value your company, yes or no? You need to value a share, right? For you to go to the next level of financial management, last part of F9, that's part F talks about what? You guys have a look. What does it talk about? It talks about business valuation. How to place a value on the business after you have taken proper investing, financing, and risk management techniques in hand. How do you put a value on that business after these three decisions have been taken? That's the whole of F9. Is that clear? Right? I'll come to the structure of the exam in some time, but the whole of F9, understand, majorly you're talking about three headings. You're talking about three decisions: investing, financing, and risk management. The next level in financial management is to value your business when you want to go public. But then within investment decisions, you have something called working capital management, which will come handy. So these are the areas of testing. And for sure, one question, a 20 marker, is from investment decisions, most probably a net present value calculation, right? 50 to pass, again think, now not repeating the mistakes that we've been doing in the past. For today, it's okay, we'll start off slow, but later onwards, all the answers, everything, Excel typed, put into the Google Classroom on time. Is that clear? Right, we'll do that religiously from day two, not day one. Day one can be a bit relaxing. But then from day two, our attack should be, you know, we should learn from our mistakes, and I also learned from the way you did it last time. We'll try to update it, everything, and we'll try to have a proper Excel sheet. I have created a Google Classroom from day one, which means all your typed in answers will go there. Time to time, I'll check and give a feedback. Right? So if we start practicing that this level, hopefully we'll pass. Right? Leave the passing side, that's not what we aim for. We'll try to understand it every day. Right? Are you guys okay with this syllabus mapping? Right? Detailed syllabus and everything, I'll later give it to you. That's not required, but the idea is this. Now, for the next part, if you can go to the syllabus map, guys, let's go to the exam structure. One page below this. I'll just, tell you how your exam is going to look like. Computer-based exam, 3 hours, three sections. Okay, three sections. Section A, 15 questions, each worth 2 marks. Most probably multiple. Here and there, a bit of objective. 15 questions, 2 marks. So that's 30 marks for section A. Section B, you will have 5 questions, right? Sorry, 3 questions and each with 5 subsections. Same, F5, same pattern for F5, you'll have this. You'll have 3 questions with 5 subsections. And then section C, you'll have 220 markers. Both are compulsory. One of the 20 marker for sure, they have mentioned it on the site itself, is going to be from working capital management, or strike that working capital management off, it's going to be from investment appraisal, which we are going to do it today itself. Okay. I'm targeting at least about 62 cases before you go to the exam. That's the highest. 62 exam cases before you go to the exam. In and out, typed in, every number worked, possibly every theory done. This is our target. Okay, we'll see how we'll achieve it. But the plan here is, the route map on how to achieve this should be very clear. For the first time in life, I sat and worked on this yesterday before I came to you all. Right? So, understand it very logically. It's a subject, 50 marks, achievable. It's nothing like F5, where you have to think too much for nothing. It's not something like invoice lines. Remember, invoice lines and invoices. It's nothing like that. It's a very okay subject, right? Financial management, managing your resources. Three decisions. Exam structure is A, B, and C. A talks about 15 mark questions or 15 questions each worth 2 marks. Section B is talking about 3 questions each having 5 subsections. And section C is where you have to focus on 220 markers, out of which one is out by now. So your handling capacity or the grip on the subject is much more than FI. That's what I'd like to say. So capitalizing on that, let's try to attack it slowly. Right? I'll come to the exam structures in some time. But again, the approach here is, okay, most of you guys are aware, but Charan and Vidya, the approach is, should I start working on the multiple choice questions or should I start working on the 20 mark questions first? What do you think? Why? Yes, with that. So in terms of training, never train yourself with 15 or multiple choice questions. You cannot do 100 multiple choice questions and say you can do a case. That's wrong. But you can do a single case and answer at least 20 multiple choice questions. That's the logic. So when you train with section C first, right? So that's what you're going to do today, right? 60% of what we discussed, understandable? Wipe it off from your head, not required. Now let's get into work. Now, we're going to take one decision in terms of financial management. I am interested in taking this decision first. Investment decisions or investing decisions. Now my question to you is this, guys. What do you actually mean by this investment? What is it actually meaning? What is this? Everyone is like, each and every fellow today is investment. What is the investment? What do you actually mean by investment? Yeah. No issue. So what do you mean by this investment? Charan, Abhi. Perfect. If you have some resources, you employ it into a business to make your returns. Yes or no? That's how you take an investing decision. But for you to take an investing decision, there should be a guide. There should be a guide. Right? You don't go and invest in each and everything. There should be a guide. Basically, the nature in investment is that you put X, you should be getting X plus. Yes or no? You're putting 10, you should be getting 10 plus. That's an investment. Right? But you have many options. How to select, what to select, all those things are your investment decision. But to keep it very simple, guys, in F9, when you take investment decisions, there are a few techniques that will help you to take that decision. And you have to know those techniques. Okay? One is referred to as something called the net present value. So if you have a particular investment, if you want to invest in that particular decision, what you can do is, you can look at what the net present value says. Right? Then there's another technique called payback. Most of you all have heard this. There's something called discounted payback. Something called ROCE. There's something called accounting rate of return. There's something called internal rate of return. Have you heard these terms, guys? So you have a potential investment with you. Okay. You have to know whether to invest in it, yes or no. You need to know that, right? So how will you know it? My question is, how will you know it? Okay, you have so many investment options around you, but you know, you have to pick and choose and invest. How will you do it? F9 tells, with the help of these techniques, which you have to know. Right? There's something called NPV, net present value. There's something called payback, or another version of it, discounted payback. There's something called ROCE. There's something called accounting rate of return. There's something called internal rate of return. So, we'll keep it very simple. We're trying to pull off an investment decision. We're trying to, you know, understand where to invest. For that, we have these techniques to help us screen an investment, or we have these techniques to help us appraise an investment. Do you understand what investment appraisal is? Yes or no, guys? Investment appraisal. What does the heading mean? Appraisal means you're screening the viability of the investment. How will you do it? These are the techniques. And for today, I'm only interested in that. I'm only interested in a net present value calculation. Are we okay? We're trying to figure out how to work out on a 20 mark case with NPV. But don't worry, we'll go step by step. Right? Now, you need a piece of paper, okay, Vidya? I just said go paper free, but of course, you need a book, Charan, you also. Like, not completely, you need something like each and every part we go through the syllabus. I prefer to do it through steps. So, now what you guys can do is give the heading as investment appraisal. Give the heading as investment appraisal. And below that, say discounted cash flow method. Discounted cash flow method. Discounted cash flow method, within brackets, net present value. Net present value, right? So they will give you a case. Okay, that's going to be a page long. You will have to know how to ascertain the net present value and guide them to an investment decision. Do you understand what they're expecting from you? It's a 20 mark scenario where you will have to put numbers and a lot of things into play to figure out what the net present value is and then advise them on taking that investment decision. So the first technique that is going to help us do this is something called net present value. It has an equivalent name called the discounted cash flow method. Are we okay? I'll tell you why it's called discounted cash flow method and everything in some time. But to, you know, go and attack and, you know, get a net present value on board, to, you know, attack that 20 marks, we should have a plan. Or instead, we should have a number of steps that will help us smooth things. So what I'll do is, say, it'll come in 5 steps. Your entire net present calculation will seal it off in 5 steps, right? As we know, activity-based costing, we sealed it off in how many steps? Can I fire a missile from here to Bangalore directly? 5? 6? 6? 6. So same way, Charana and Vidya, will everything we go, will, you know, try to put in steps and, you know, ease ourselves. Step 1. Okay, just as step 1, initial findings. Okay, initial findings. Now, below these steps, as sub points, you can just put it. Size of the investment, first bulletin, size of the investment. Life of the project. Cost of capital. I'll tell you what all this means. Just put it down for the time being. I'll tell you what it means. Cost of capital. Next point. Working capital requirements. Leave some space over there and come to step 2. So guys, get used to it. If you're given a 20 mark scenario to take an investment decision, and if that was to calculate the net present value, how many steps do we have? Get used to it. 5. Of which the first one is to sort out what? Initially, you find these things in the scenario, right? See what the size of the investment is. So what do you mean by size of the investment? How much you have to invest in this, right? Life of the project. For how many years is this investment going to go ahead? Cost of capital. Now, what do you mean by cost of capital? I said, if you have an investment decision, what's the next decision that you have to take? Financing decision, yes or no, right? Maybe take a loan. Does it come to you for free or does it come with a cost? When you issue shares, does it come to you for free or does it come with a cost? It's referred to as cost of capital, yes or no? So the cost of debt or dividends together is referred to as the cost of capital. So initially, you'll have to search for all these things, right? And then working capital requirement, I'll tell you in some time. That's what you do in step 1. Are we okay? So you jot these in step 1. Step 2. Identify the associated relevant cash flows. underline the word relevant. Okay, underline the word relevant. I'll tell you why. But cash flows, guys, we are not talking about profits, we are not talking about anything, we are talking about cash flows. What's the difference between profits and cash flows? Difference between profits and cash flows, guys. Profit is profit, cash flow is cash flow. Tell me. What a definition, man. It is the definition of the century. What a definition. That should go into the books of ACC, actually. Profit is an accrual concept, yes or no? Do you... Okay. You deduct depreciation, right? You take into account of your credit sales and all these things when you accumulate profits. We talk about cash flows. How much is actually flowing in liquid cash is the count, yes or no? Which is close to reality. Cash flows. You can say that your business is having 10 crores of profit, but in the bank, what is there is what matters at the end of the day. So when you take an investment decision, it's better to look into the cash flows rather than the profit aspect. So step two of any investment appraisal, especially with net present value, is to identify your relevant cash flows. Right? So that's why I said cash flows, and I again use the word relevant. Relevant meaning the cash flows that are relevant to that particular investment. Not generally to the whole business, but to that particular investment is what you have to focus on. I'll make sense to you when you're doing the case, but for now, just, you know, have an eye on these words. Now, cash flows can be two in nature. One can be a cash in and a cash out. Right? You can have cash inflows and outflows. So when you said cash flows, can you split that into two branches? Can you split that into two branches? And on one side you say cash inflows, and the other side you say cash outflows. Right, now I have a question to you. Okay, I can't open a factory. One of you will open a factory. Okay, I know that I'm not that capable. One of you will open a factory, right? Is that an investment? Say a manufacturing plant, huge manufacturing of linen shirts, exporting everything, you manufacture it. That's a business, yes or no? Opening up that factory and, you know, putting in that equipment, that's an investment, yes or no? Yeah. That investment will give you cash flows, yes or no? What kind of cash flows can you expect from that investment? Sales. Okay. Some are saying, say, I'll tell it. I'll just simply name it. Under the inflows, can I say sales to be a cash inflow from that investment? Yes or no? The first thing from that investment is going to be your sales. Yes or no? What's coming in? So first bullet point under cash inflows will be sales revenue. Sales revenue. I just finished an F3 class and we were doing bank reconciliations. It's still in my head. I don't like that thing. Who found this double entry, man? Seriously. What goes in, what is it? What goes in? Debitor. What goes out is creditor. You apply that dumb logic to some questions, it goes wrong actually. It's not fine. I don't know. Like, it was a messed up thing. Okay, fine. Anyway. Sales revenue. Now come under cash outflows. First bullet point. First bullet point. Variable costs. Variable costs. Now, why did I specifically mention variable costs? Can anyone of you tell? It proportionally varies with the investment you have made. Yes or no? If your factory is going to produce 5,000 shirts, the variable cost will be for 5,000. If it's going to produce 10,000, for 10,000. So it's a relevant cash flow. Yes or no? It changes. As per your decision, it changes. Sales is a relevant inflow. If you decide to sell 10,000, you will get the sale of 10,000. Less than that, less than that. So it changes. But that being said, under cash inflows, second bullet point, associated residual value. Associated residual value. Now, can you dismantle the factory and sell it after 5 years? Will that give you an inflow? That's also an inflow, right? That's also an inflow from the investment. So that's what I mean. Residual value. Under outflows. Referred to as relevant fixed costs. Not every fixed cost matters, but relevant fixed cost, yes. I'll tell you why in some time. Below that, below outflows, next bullet point, opportunity cost. And relevant losses. Opportunity cost and relevant losses. I'll tell you what this means when we actually go to the case. But for the time being, just put it there. So if you want to figure out, or if you want to take out an investment decision, and if that investment decision was to calculate the net present value, I said there are 5 steps. What do we do first? Register all this in your mind. What do we do first? Initial findings. You run through the entire case and you figure out a few things. Like size of the investment, life of the project, cost of capital, working capital requirements. I'll tell you what this means in some time. But then if that part is sorted, you go on to step two. What is step two? Identify the relevant cash flows, not profits, cash flows, right? No problem. That will be your cash inflows and that will be your cash outflows. This is a probable list of inflows. That's a probable list of outflows. But if ever you have the chance of finding contribution, do that at first. What is contribution? What minus what is contribution? Sales minus variable cost. So if ever you have a chance of finding contribution in your appraisals, that should be a shortcut. So I'll just tell that. Don't write it, but just put that. Right? Step three. Don't write this. I'm just asking you guys. Sometimes investment goes on, right? 4 years, 5 years, 6. They go on in this economy, right? It goes on. The economy is subject to inflation. Yes or no? So should your investment also be subject to inflation? Probably yes. Okay. So step three, adjust for inflation. But when you do a business like what I said, a manufacturing plant and all those things, at the end of the day, cash flows turn out to be profits. Yes or no? Can you enjoy the whole thing or should you pay tax? Because like Vidya said, variable cost, fixed cost and all these things are operational costs. Yes or no? But it's nothing like an government imposing taxation. Nothing of that is counted in step two. But step four, guys. Account for taxation. And when you said taxation, can you split that into two branches? Actually, fair syllabus, you'll find taxation in two parts. Okay, this is not a detailed tax like F6, but for us to go with the calculation, we'll do taxation in two parts. Part A, tax depreciation calculation. Part B, tax payment calculation. Or you can just say tax payment. It's fine. Tax payment. Step five. Okay, fine. So step four, taxation. Taxation in two parts. I'll tell you what this means, guys, in some time. But then step five, determination of NPV, determination of NPV, within brackets, table. Guys, this is how you will approach 20 marks, right? You go through the steps, you apply to the scenario, you should be landing in 20 marks. For today, I will not tell you to use an Excel, but from tomorrow onwards, that's mandatory, right? Okay. So that's 5 steps to you. And that's also key to 20 marks. But how we apply this to a case and everything, we'll work it on a piece of paper for today, there's no issue. But from tomorrow onwards, we'll get in the Excel. Do you have the other document, TUTE, with you, which says investment appraisal or IENV app? Can you open it up? Are we okay? You have Q1 that talks about a hotel. Do you have question 1 that talks about a hotel? The management of a hotel. Yeah. We have to apply F9 to that particular scenario. Especially the investment decision, that wing should be applied here. And we should be able to tell how to do their financial management in terms of an investment decision with net present value. Do you get what I say? Right? In other terms, we'll have to use the 5 steps and then guide them to do a financial management in terms of the investment decision. How to do it and everything in some time. But given to you is a scenario that talks about an investment. Right? In this investment, you will find many things coming up. So how we are going to decide and tell whether this is a yes or a no is what we are trying to exercise and understand. So we'll do one thing. Vidya, can you start reading? Usually it's Abhi who is reading, but since you're new, I'll make you read. Yeah. Yeah. Just a minute, Vidya. Just a minute. We'll stop, understand and go. So it's, don't get offended. It's a normal thing that you stop. Right? Okay. Sometimes it might be irritating, but there's no choice. Okay, so now in terms of this hotel, what are they trying to do? What are they trying to do? It's a hotel, what are they trying to do? Expand. Into what? Expanding into gymnasium and spa for the guests, but from a hotel's perspective, this is an investment that they make to attract more customers, yes or no? So, as a financial manager or as a part of financial management, you should be able to tell whether that's a yes or a no, yes or no? In business, we always do something like, it's always like that, whether you like it or not. It's a dirty thing, but when our profits are exceeding, or when our cash flows are exceeding, the inflows are exceeding the outflows is when we say yes to something, yes or no? Right? Even here, okay, the idea is to invest in a gymnasium and spa, but we have to look at the financial viability. We have to do an investment appraisal about it. Yes or no? How we'll do? 5 steps. I don't know how we're going to do the 5 steps, but yeah, that's what I have for you. But do you understand that the investment is to expand? Right? Go ahead. Just a minute. Yeah, just a minute. Now, in terms of the additional facilities, one thing is for sure. What is for sure? Your room occupancies are going to go up. It's going to go up. And the charge that you're charging for the customers can increase, which means it's a good sign to your inflows. It's a good sign for you to, you know, charge the customer. You might get some more. But you have to invest in the gymnasium and spa basic. But the problem here is you have to decide. If I open the gymnasium and spa, am I going to get enough to cover the costs, right? That's what you have to see in an investment decision. We'll see. Read. Okay, now, just now Vidya read about that 100,000, yes or no? Yeah, 100,000, yeah, $1,00,000. No issue, no issue, no problem. Is it step 1, 2, 3, 4 or 5? One, exactly what is that 100,000 that you're talking about? Size of the investment. What is the investment? Okay. The investment is to expand it into a gymnasium and spa. Yes, on. So, size of the investment is 1 lakh. What is the investment? Expanding. Yes, on. Now, as you read the scenario, I want you to unfold the steps slowly. Is that okay? Meaning, as you pass through each, you try to make a match with the steps. Right? We'll see. We'll try to an extent. The idea should be, as you finish reading the case, in your mind you should have finished the 5 steps. Right? In that way, if you know that for sure an investment appraisal question is going to shoot out in your exam, you should have hold on that. At least by 12 minutes, you should be able to, you know, chuck it and finish it off. Right? Happened with F5. I thought it will happen with F5, but it never. But it's a try. Okay, it's again a try. People have done it, so that's what I'm telling you. 12-15 minutes, we'll try to sort it out, but that's going to take a lot of practice, but we'll try. But keep in mind that when you read the entire case, you're never going to read it again and again and again because you don't have the time. So when you read it for the first time, it's very important that you register a few things in your mind and unfold the steps within. Right? It'll happen. I'm not saying it'll happen in this case, but as you go 2-3 cases, because it's the same format. Right? It'll happen slowly. Right, Vidya, go ahead. So can I say size of the investment is 150,000? Right? Size of the investment should be 150,000. Go ahead. Just a minute. Life of the project is how many years? 4 years. Because this expansion is only worth for 4 years, which means the appraisal that you should be doing for this particular investment is over a period of 4 years. So that also unfolds initial finding, life of the project. Yes or no? Right? Are you okay with this, guys? Right. Go ahead. Right. Which step is that? Directly on to you. Which step is that? 15,000. Can I say, yeah. Can I say step 2? Can I say residual value? Disposal, that's an inflow, yes or no? Right, here, go ahead. Which means they're talking about step 3 also, because step 3 talks about inflation. We'll see how to do it, we'll see, but yeah, they're talking about something like step 3. Right, go ahead. Just a minute. Now, it's okay if you didn't do F5, it's okay, but I'll ask the balance. Guys, we did F5, right? That relevant costing part we did, right? Remember? Do you remember something like feasibility report there? Okay, did we talk about relevant cost of materials? I'll catch you. Go ahead with it. Go ahead. That 10,000 for the time being, keep it aside, but I'll catch these fellows in some time. You go ahead. There's a lot of information, right? The current, regarding the room rates, current occupancy is 80%. Number of rooms available is 40. Current average room rate per night is about 250. Now, all this information is vital, but let me ask you, which steps do they belong to? This piece of the question belongs to which step? Can I say step 2? 2, right? Because it talks about the inflows, it talks about the costs. So I'm talking about cash flows, basically. Right? So step 2, let's see. Right, go ahead. Just a minute. Just a minute. Now, if you go into a gymnasium and spa, which is your investment, your income pattern is going to change. Yes or no? It's going to take a next step. To what is it going to raise? It's going to go to how much? I think from 80%, it goes to 82%. That's what is important. From 80 to 82%. So if you make this investment, again, I'm again repeating, if you make this investment, the occupancy jumps from 80 to 82%. It's not just 82% directly, from. Right? From. One important thing is from. Go ahead. Yes, go ahead. I'll tell you this. You go ahead. Yeah. Just a minute, India. Now, let's register a few numbers. Do you remember the 150,000 guys? What is 150,000? Perfect. Do you remember 4 years? Do you remember 15,000? I know it's too much for the first day, but you know, why is it important is because you don't go to it again, right? So when you read it for the first time, 100% of it, especially with F9 in investment appraisal, 100% of your attention there, grab it and then forget it. Like when you go and do the question, at a stretch, you know, you need to work it out. So that's why. Then we were talking about a $250, you remember that? $250. I think it's the average room rate per night, right? 40 rooms, 80% occupancy, it might increase to 82%, and you can increase the rates by 5%, right? So I'm not telling you put everything together, but if you have a control and grip on things, better. Right now, look at the staffing. If you go and open the gymnasium and spa, you will require staff. How many in number? 4, right? Per year, you'll require four in number, but every year you need to pay them 30K. Yes, sir. Each of them should be paid about 30K. With regard to overheads, whatever Nitya read, I see $80 per square meter and 400 square meters. And guys, you're on F2, right? Oh, you got exempted from F2. Okay, fine. I'll come to that part in some time, but then if you can go to the next point with you. Right, just a minute there. Now, in terms of this, there's a 42,000 of overheads that is going to raise directly as a result of your investment. Yes, ma'am. It's a very, very important thing, because if you do this investment, it will increase by 42,000. Yes, ma'am. If you do this, that will happen. That's like that. And then with regard to inflation, that's what step to us. 3. So we'll there is inflation. We'll worry about it in step 3. They say 4%. It's applicable to sales. It's applicable to overhead and staff costs. And they clearly say that 4% will apply from year 2. What's the life of the project? Inflation happens from which year specifically? Second year onwards. So second year onwards, inflation is going up. We'll see what to do it and how to do it. But then, yeah, let's go on to taxation. Right. For the time being, I'm not looking at Bulletin 3, but I'm taking a few words from Bulletin 1 and 2, or especially on Bulletin 2. This year's tax, do we pay it this year? I'm generally asking you a question, like in your case. This year's tax, we never pay it any year. That's our concept, right? No, we have to pay tax, right? But this year's tax, most probably we'll pay it next year. Most probably. Okay, you'll pay it next year, fine. So there is a 1 year delay. But with this regime, half of that tax is payable in the year and the balance half in the next year, right? And there's something called tax depreciation, which I'll tell you to you in some time. But the third bullet point, just keep it out for some time. Yanita, if you're with you, if you can go to the next part, we can finish it off. Yeah, go ahead. Just a minute. 12% cost of capital. Yes or no? So, if ever you have to borrow money, at what rate? 12%. Right? 12% is the borrowing rate. So, can I say that any investment that you do with this company should give a minimum of 12%? Yes or no? See, because if you took 150,000 and employed it in a business, a proper financial management aspect should be, at least you should be able to pay that amount plus the interest on which you borrowed. Yes or no? That's break even. So if you took 150,000 and employed in a business, the investment at least should give that initial outlay, that is the 150,000 plus that 12%. Yes or no? So understand one thing, in any investment decision, the minimum that the investment should give back is the cost of capital. That's the minimum. Anything on top of it is profit. But the minimum that a project should return is the cost of capital. Now let's see how to assess it. But we are using a technique to assess this investment. What's the technique, guys? Net present value. And we have five steps to apply to a scenario and get the answer. But how to do it properly and perfectly, we'll try to do it now. Right? But we read the entire thing. I'm sure that you're okay with the scenario. The scenario is very simple. It's a hotel. They're trying to expand, which is their investment, into a gymnasium and spa with $150,000, and this is going to be worth over 4 years. If they do so, they can increase their room rates and occupancy to enjoy a bit of increased revenue. But is this viable over 4 years after your taxation and inflation happening in the economy? You have to answer. But the minimum that this investment should give is 12%. Because if ever the company is going to borrow, they're going to borrow money or finance at 12%. Is that okay? But how to give a final say, whether it's a yes or a no, whether they should open the gymnasium and spa, whether it's a yes or a no, how do you go and tell that? Yes, we have to apply the five steps, right? So slowly what we'll do is we'll work together. You can work it on a piece of paper for today, there's no issue. But before that, tell me guys, can you see the board? Now, what we'll do is this. Five steps. I understand it's a bit more for this day, but I'm not going to write down the first step for sure because we have almost sorted it out, right? But I'm just going to go through it with you. In terms of our initial findings, are we okay with the size of the investment? Guys, are we okay with the size of the investment? Eldo? Nair? Okay. Are you okay with the life being 4 years? Are you okay with the cost of capital being 12%? I didn't come across any working capital requirements, but with the next question, I'll tell you what working capital and how it applies, but not in this question. So I'll slowly try to move on to step two. What is step two telling me? What is step two telling me? Cash flows. It asks you to find the relevant cash flows, right? But cash flows with a project can be inflows and can be outflows. Yes or no? We got to be a bit careful over there. Now, before I go on to this, before sorting out the cash flows, let me ask you this question. You're currently in a job, right? Now you move to a better job. Of course, when I'm meaning better, the pay is better, right? So initially, in the job that you're currently doing, J1, and the new job, J2, say you're earning $50,000. Okay, nice number, right? Even I'm waiting for my salary. Next, J2, you're having $75,000. What strikes a bell? Of course, there's no doubt on it. Which factor strikes the bell? Which factor is your interest? Is it the 50,000? Is it the entire 75,000? Or is it the incremental 25,000? Incremental, yes or no? Why you moved on to job two is like that incremental 25,000 cash flows, yes or no? Right? Now, already you're in business, you're in a hotel business, you're running a number of rooms, yes or no? You're getting some money, but why do you open the gymnasium and the spa? Can I say to increase that occupancy from 80 to 82%? Yes or no? Can I say from the average room rate per night of $250, you can now charge 5% more? That's the striking thing. That's why you're moved with this investment. Yes or no? So remember, guys, if you're given an investment appraisal question, to look at the aspect of cash flows. Right? It might be a thing that you're starting from the scratch, then it's fine. But some kind of investments is just an expansion of the existing business strategy, is just an expansion. In that case, you should be worried about the incremental cash flows. You should not be worried about 50,000, you should not be worried about 75,000, but you should be interested in that incremental 25,000. But this job too might be in another city, in another, everything in another, but are you able to gain from that 25,000 is what you have to look at, right? Yes, you can go to Delhi and you will gain the entire thing. No, I didn't tell that. Suppose if you got a job in Bangalore and you got a job in Delhi, right? One is 50,000 and one is 75,000. Where will you go? Are you from Delhi, Charan? Thank God. Okay. Okay, fine. Are you from Delhi, Vidya, by any chance? Thanks. But are you Delhi support? No. Thank you for that. You never go to Delhi. That's the takeaway of the story. Okay, now what we'll do is this. We have to sort out the cash flows, and you guys tell me, how do I sort the cash flows? Now, am I interested in the just cash flows or the incremental cash flows in this case? Of course, we are interested in the incremental cash flows. Yes or no? Now, my next question to you is this. How do we get that? This will have to work a bit, right? Okay, let's do this. Hey guys, while doing one of your classes, right, I broke the pen with your class, right? It went flying and it broke with your class, right? With F5, right? No. Our screen is in your class, but the pen was not in your class, right? Yesterday, I again checked what my equipments are. I lost a pen. I got another one today. I don't know what I'm doing, man. Seriously. Okay. Sales. Right, I'm going to write sales. Right? On one side, I'm going to say existing sales. And on the other side, I'm going to say potential sales. Are we okay? How much of sales does the existing business make? How do we get that? Can I say they make their sales from 40 rooms, but only 80% of it is occupied, and each occupancy is going to drag them $250 of cash? Yes or no? Right? So I'm talking about a sale of how much? But that is for a day. Yes or no? How much are we talking about? Is it 10,000? I'm not sure. I think. Suresh says it's fine. Okay, so we have $8,000 of sales. Now, is this sale per year, per week, or per day? Per day. Now, I'll tell you one more thing. Usually, the investment appraisals, we appraise it over a period of 12 months or 1 year. So, all our accumulation of cash flows are always for 1 year. So can I convert this per day amount into a year? I remember that the hotel was open for 360 days in a year. That's what Vidya did, I guess. Yes? Right. So can I have the annual income? Okay. 28 million? Is that okay? No. Okay. I am not sure of this number. If you don't tell me the correct number, the whole thing will go wrong. So tell it to me. In millions, tell me. You're going to read it like a cell phone number, is it? Okay. Okay. It's 2,880,000. Okay, fine. Now can I look at potential sales? What is the thing that if you invest, if you go ahead with the investment, how much of sales can you potentially make? I think the number of rooms will remain the same, but the occupancy now goes to 82%. And now you'll be charging $262.5. Yes or no? Why? Because that's a 5% increase in the room rates. Yeah? So how much am I talking about? It's about $8,610. But that's for a single day. I convert it to an annual income. Gives me about 3 million. 3 million? 10. Is that correct? Perfect. So 3,099,600. Now my question is, are you interested in the entire 3,099,600? Are you interested in the 2,880,000? Or can I say of the 3,099,600, 2,880,000 is not new to you, right? It's not new. Even if you're going in the existing business, you'll earn that amount. Yes or no? So what is the incremental sale? It's $219,600. Yes or no? Yes or no? But can I tell you, this is the incremental relevant cash inflow. Yes or no? Because sales is the inflow, that's what you wrote in step 2, yes or no? Because remember, still we are doing step 2. Still we are doing step 2. So still we only have incremental sales. It's only the inflow that we're talking about, yes or no? But now I want to go to the outflow side of things. I want to go to the outflow side of things. The first outflow that we would have taken down is variable cost. What is variable here? I think there's no such variable cost, yes or no? But there's fixed costs. I said you, below variable cost, I said you, a relevant fixed cost is also a cash outflow, yes or no? Yeah? Staffing, look at the first one, staffing. What kind of cost? It's per annum, it's fixed, yes or no? But you have to see whether it's relevant, yes or no, for the particular investment. Is staffing relevant for the investment? I guess without the staff, you cannot have the gym and the spa. Yes or no? So if you want the incremental revenue of 219,600, you got to employ staff. Yes or no? So is staff relevant to the investment? Yes. So can I take that relevant fixed cost into the calculation? Yes, you have to. Do you understand? If I guess, I'm pretty okay with that, but Vidya and Charan, are you okay with that? Right, so what I'm going to do is, staff cost. You cannot enjoy the whole 219,600, you have to suffer 120,000, yes or no? Why? Because 30,000 per annum fixed per staff. That's about 4 people working for you. 120,000. Is that okay? Now, the other kind of fixed cost that we have is overheads. Right? Indirect costs. Let me put it like that. On the bullet, or the first bulletin, it talks about 80 per square meter, and the area required for the gymnasium and spa is 400 square meters. Yes or no? So what is it, guys? What kind of calculation comes over here? Now, like staff cost, if I am to write overheads, how much of cost should I put over there? 42,000. Only. not 80 into 400? Why, Vidya? Why not 80 into 400? Perfect. That's perfect. Because the gymnasium and spa is going to be replaced. It's going to be replaced, right? What was currently in that space? Go to the case and check. What was currently in the space? It was a library. A hotel with a library is a total failure. Okay. Okay, fine. So, the library is now going to be a gymnasium and spa. Do they talk about any increase in the size? Or is it the same space? Do they talk about this increasing in size, gymnasium and spa increasing in size? They don't talk about anything, yes or no? Which means the library also occupied 400 square meters, yes or no? Even if it's a library, even if it's a gymnasium and spa, even if there's nothing over there, still the apportionment of overheads will work as 400 into 80, yes or no? Is that investment specific cost or is it a general cost? Which one is that? It's general. It's not investment specific because clearly in step 2, it talks about relevant cash flows. Relevant to the investment. That is general to the business. Because if you do nothing also, still the overhead apportionment cost is going to be 400 square meters into 80. It's existent. It's not going to change as a result of you taking this investment. So what is relevant is any cost or income that changes as a result of your investment decision. That is what is relevant. You should be very clear with that, right? On that grounds, the first 80 into 400 square meters don't qualify as a relevant cost. It's anyway going to happen like Vidya says. Is that fine? Charun, are you okay with that? Hello, though? Abhi? Suresh? Nair? Okay, so what I'm going to do is, but still I'm keeping overheads. And can you tell me how much of these overheads should go into the calculation? Like Vidya says, oh, why 42,000 only? Because, perfectly, the word says, exactly. So, in terms of the overheads, it's the 42,000 directly increasing as a result of the gymnasium and the spa. So if you do this investment, the overheads are directly going to increase by 42,000 is relevant. Because if you don't have the gymnasium and spa, you won't be having this cost. Is that okay? So which means the $42,000, they become a relevant overhead. Are we okay? Right. So we're done with overheads, but we need to talk about inflation. Now, inflation is the next step. But remember, we are still in step 2. Yes or no? So we'll leave that to the next step. So to finish off step 2, what we'll do is, we'll take the net of this. And we'll keep the net cash flow ready. Is that okay? Can I know how much is that? Incremental cash flows. I refer to as incremental cash flows. $57,600 is possible if you open the gymnasium and spa according to this setup of relevancy, right? According to the principles of relevancy, you might experience $57,600 per annum if you open the gymnasium and spa. So according to us, we have done with step 2. Let's move on to step 3. What is step 3 saying? Inflation. We need to adjust the cash flows for inflation. Is that okay? But to do that, I need information. Initial findings, what's the life of the project? 4 years. So inflation is happening over 4 years. So what I have to do is when working with inflation, you got to be a bit careful. Right? I'm going to mark it like 1, 2, 3 and 4. Are we okay? Now, go to the note inflation. There is a rate that is applicable to specific things. What rate is applicable to which part of the investment? 4% for sales. I'm ticking it. Check and see. 4% over there. 4% for staff and 4% for overheads. Am I correct? Can I say instead of inflating each of this individually, I'll inflate this? See, instead of inflating each of these components individually, I can inflate 57,600 totally, yes or no? Makes sense, right? So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to say the cash flows. Every year is going to be 50, how much? 57,600, are you okay? But on this side, I'm going to say inflated cash flows. You tell me how much. I think year one will still remain at 57,600, yes or no? But from year two onwards, the 4% will apply. Yes? How much? Can you inflate 57,600 by 4%? 59,904. You have a calculator? I do have a calculator, but I don't know where it is. Okay, Vidya, I think it should be fine. Abhi, do you have the answers with you? How much up? Year 3? Okay, now year 3 is a problem to you, I understand. It should be 57,600 into 1.04 to the power 2, yes or no? Because inflation is a compounding thing. Or else what you can do is, you can inflate 59,904. Because it's chain based, right? Inflation is chain based. See, inflation keeps on, prices keep on rising on the previous price, yes or no? For example, today if it's 10 rupees, tomorrow it's 12 rupees, next year it should be increasing from 10 or from 12? From 12. So which means, do one thing, inflate 59,904. How much is that? We have $62,300 and then we have yes, Abhi. Just a minute. How irritating this thing is, right? Okay, how much is this? No, I just meant this board. I mean this, to write on this thing here. How much is that, Abhi? Last one? Okay. Are we okay? Right, so this is how you deal with inflation. Now remember, if you had different rates, something for sales, something for staff cost, you can't do this. You will have to individually inflate the cash flows. Are we okay? Now, can I ask you a question? Step 1, 2, 3, are they clear? Till this point. So far, is it looking okay? Right, then let's go on to which step, you tell me. We go to taxation, which is not like F6 taxation, very normal taxation we have. And if you ask me that F6 taxation, I don't know. That's my answer. Right? Step 4. In terms of taxation, we'll work it in two parts, guys. I said you in the note. What are the two parts? Step 1, there's something called? Yes. There's something called tax depreciation calculation, and then there's something called the tax payment. So let me work on the tax depreciation. It's a small format, guys. I'll tell you what this means, but if you can work it out with me, good. First column should be years. I know we're having like how many? 4 years. That's beginning value, BV. It's not how like how it sounds. Beginning value, BV, and then tax depreciation. And then I'm looking at you, Suresh. End value is EV. Right? Now, I'll tell you what this tax depreciation everything is in some time. Most probably you know it by now, but let me ask you this. What's the beginning value of your investment? what's the beginning value of your investment? I think it's about 150,000. Yes or no? And as Vidya read it, under the taxation rules, first bullet point, what's the tax depreciation policy? What's the tax depreciation policy? Reducing balance, 25%. Yes or no? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put that 25% over here. Reducing balance. I'm telling you, can you do a reducing balance method on the 150,000? But before you do that, I think at the end of the fourth year, the end value of your investment should be how much? Did we come across a 15,000 residual value? This investment had a beginning value of 150,000, but at the end of the 4 years, it should be 15,000. Is that okay? Now, can you do one thing, guys? Can you do a reducing balance method on the 150,000? 25% of 150,000, how much is that? Okay. EV. The end value of year one should be the beginning value of year two. Then I'm talking about how much? Yeah. Suresh, where is the answer? Tell me, how much? 8, 4, 3, 7, 5. No, it cannot come to 15,000. It won't. It won't. You'll have to fill the gap. So don't worry about that. 21. Now what you do is 63,282 should become 15,000, which means the balancing charge or the balancing figure is how much? I'll tell you what it means. Okay, I'll tell you what it means. But keep this ready. Keep this tape. 40? Okay. Okay, no issue. Yeah, that's fine. Are we okay? So just keep this ready. But then we'll have to move on to the next part. What's the next part? In taxation, we have two parts. This is one. Now it's a tax payment calculation. Now you tell me. If you do a business, you expect some kind of support from the government. Yes or no? Are you okay to... Okay, go on to bulletin 2. How much of taxation do they charge? 30% on your profits, yes or no? That's a huge amount, yes or no? That's quite a huge amount. Most of the businesses will not do businesses if this is the case. So the tax authorities give you some kind of concession. I'll tell you how to do that concession. But before that, again, I'm going to mark, this is part 2 of taxation. I'm going to mark the years 1, 2, 3 and 4. And one of you all have to tell me the cash flows. But now we should be using the inflated cash flows, right? It should be 57,600. Then you said me 59,904. Then you said me 62,300. Then 64,792 you said me, yeah? Right. The tax authorities will want 30% of this. Because they say 30% on profits. And do you agree that 57,600 is something like profits? It's a cash flow, but ultimately it's profit. Why? From the sales you have deducted all the costs. Yes or no? But no organization is ready to give 30% of this. What the tax authority says is, okay, then I'll do one thing. I'll give you a small concession. That concession is tax depreciation, which means look at the tax depreciation table. How much of tax depreciation do you get in the first year? they say, do one thing, don't pay 30% of 57,600. Instead, from the 57,600, 37,500 is not taxable. So tax depreciation becomes the concession of your profits. Do you understand? The tax authorities will not accept accounting depreciation, but they will accept tax depreciation. Because if you say accounting depreciation, for the first year you will say 150,000. Because you can decide the accounting depreciation, yes or no? To manipulate the tax, you can decide the amount of accounting depreciation. That's after all the organization's estimate for depreciation. They can decide it. But if the organization is allowed to decide on depreciation, that might manipulate the accounts. So that's not allowed. The tax authority says, wait, instead, they will calculate a depreciation referred to as tax depreciation. So which means of the profit, the tax depreciation is not taxed. That's an exemption, right? So of the 57,600, tax depreciation of 37,500, which means what's the taxable profit? What's the taxable profit? It's about 20,100. On this, 30%. How much is that? But in year one, I'm telling you only pay half of it. Because the rule is half this year, half the next year. Yes or no? So which means, sorry. So which means, in terms of the tax, in terms of the tax paid, it's going to be 3015 and 3015 plus. Are we okay? How will you work it out for the second year? Can you fill out the table? Guys, can you fill out the table now? Get the taxable profits and then hit 30% on that. So when you're talking about the tax paid column, that should go to 3, 4, 5 and 6. Because half of the 5th year's tax will be paid in the 6th year. Oh, I'm sorry, This is 4 years, right? Sorry, it will go to 5. The life is 4 years, right? Right, guys? But I'm telling you it will go to 5. Because half of the 4th year's tax will be paid in 5. So which means the table will extend to 5 years. Okay. Okay. Okay, just a minute. Okay, that should give me. Right. So year two, it's going to be 9534 half, right? That's going to be 3015 plus 9534 half. How much is 9534 half? 4000? Right. Year 3 is going to be 4767 plus. Right? How much? Fourth year is going to be 6,181 plus. Now wait. How much? said, and 2004-76, can I say? Yeah. Are you okay with this? So guys, this is how we get the tax pay. Are you okay? Now are you okay with step 1, 2, 3 and 4? What lost? Is that last? We need to decide the net present value and say whether this is a yes or a no. We have to take that investment decision. And we'll see how to do that. I said you in brackets, it's a table. This is how you construct the table, guys. You'll have to mention the years. And since with the last working taxation went on to 5 years, I'm going to say 5 years. Are we okay? And on the first column, I'm going to say investment. Right? So it's going to be your investment, column for cash flow, a column for tax, net cash flows, 12%, I'll tell you why. Cost of capital is 12%, right? Yes. And then the final column is present value, PV. When I mention year 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, I'm mentioning at, like for example, year 1 means at the end of year 1. That's December of year 1. There's nothing called year 0, but that's January of year 1. Do you understand? 0 refers to right now. So year 0 refers to January. Right? When I say year 1 over here, that's the end of year 1. December. Most probably. After 12 months. Are we okay? Right now, how much have you to invest in this plan? How much have you to invest? I think that's the investment of 150,000. Yes, on. Yeah. I think in the first year, there is no cash flow, there is no tax, there is nothing. But now I'm going to tell you one thing. To get the present value, you need to multiply the cash flows with the discounting factors. Discounting factors is going to be, or the discounting factor is going to be the company's cost of capital. What's the company's cost of capital, guys? 12%. So this project should give a minimum of 12%. Yes or no? So this values should be discounted at 12%. Now what you can do is, Google up SEMA present value tables, or SEMA is better. SEMA present value tables, CIMA present value tables. You'll get a set of tables, right? Talks about the present value. Yes or no? Yeah. Can you go to 12% in it? And can you tell me the discounting factors at 12%? I'll tell you what this discounting factor means. At year 0, it should be 1. At the end of year 1, it should be 0. Yes. And then go on. Right. I'll tell you why I put these numbers for the time, but now So 150,000 into 1 is 150,000. Now let me focus on year 1 and I'll explain to you this. And in the investment column, guys, don't forget one thing. In the investment column, in year 0, you spend 150,000, but in year 4, you will get back 15,000. Yes or no? And this 15,000 is after the effect of inflation or before the effect of inflation? It has already been adjusted. Yes or no? That's what they say. So you don't have to worry about it. It's already being adjusted for inflation. That's what they say, right? Yeah. So don't worry about that. But now can you go to the cash flows? I remember the cash flows were 57,600. 59,904. 62,300 you said. 64,792. I'm not sure. Is this correct? Yeah. Can you enjoy the whole thing or do you have tax? I think the first year you need to pay 3015. Correct? Second year, how much you need to pay? A total of? Then $109. Then right. So what will be the net year one? If anyone can give me the numbers, 57,600 minus 3015 should give me 50. Right. Can you enjoy the whole of 54,585 or should you suffer a cost of capital of 12%? You should be suffering a cost of capital, right? Which means, what will you get into hand, net? 54,585, 0.893 is what you get. That's the time value of money. Yes, yes, Abhi, 40? 744. Are we okay? Now, guys, can you do one thing? Can you fill in this? Can you fill in that? And can you get the net? Of course, on Excel is going to be easy. I hope so. You can drag it, right? Abhi, you have the answers? Okay, Abhi, I'm not going to fill this up. Guys, I'm not going to fill this up. But Abhi, you have the answers for the total present value table. I mean, the present value column. That's minus 150,000 plus all the inflows, if it's an inflow, for the 5 years. Net it off. Somewhere around 20,600 and... Eldo, you have the answer? Eldo Nair, someone. Vidya, you have the answer? What if I say it's wrong? I'm just asking, what if I say it's wrong? Suresh, wake up, Dad. Charan, you have the answer? You have the answer, Charan? अभी ओके आई थिंक यू गाइस फॉरगॉट दिस 15,000. नो व्हाई विल इट बी माइन? इट्स अ इनफ्लो राइट, इट्स अ रेसिडुअल वैल्यू दैट यू गेट बाय सेलिंग द इन्वेस्टमेंट राइट. पूछो and remember guys last one this taxation is a payment right, so last year it should be a negative. Yeah, 20,702. Guys, do you allocate 20,007 something? Even 20,600 something is also fine. That's the perfect answer. I think that's the standard answer. 20,686 should be perfectly fine. Suresh? What is it? No. Eldo, what about you guys? Eldo, Nair, are you there? How much did you get? 20? You got the answer, is it? Okay, Charan, what about you? You are not finished. Okay. Abhi, you have the answer, Theodore. Okay, 20,000 in that range should be fine because there's rounding off errors because of taxation. That's fine. But yeah. Abhi, what about you? I didn't get you. Oh, you gave me that answer. That's fine. That should be fine. Even Charlie, your answer should be fine. 20,400 something, right? Okay. Plus or minus is okay. But it should be in the 20,000 range. 20,686 is like answer key answer. Right? You have that. Vishwana? Okay. Fine, figure it out after this, but it should be in this range. Okay, so for the day, let me tell you what's happening with this. So in terms of your financial management, remember the three decisions, guys. Actually five, I shortened it and not to put too much of pressure, I said you three, but it's actually five. Okay, remember like F9, in terms of FM gets on to, we'll initially say three headings, remember? Investment, risk management, together with working capital as well as business valuation, right? So coming to that later, we are talking about one decision, investing, right? So for us to invest, there are ways to guide us and on which we can base our decision. One of which is called the discounting cash flow method or discounted cash flow method, from which we call net present value in short. Right? So in terms of net present value, you have five steps, right? And in terms of the five steps, that's what we do. That's how you take the scenario, that's how you handle it. And if it's a positive net present value, yes, you go ahead with the project. Now my question is, what do you mean by the 20,702? Simply, okay. It sounds like this. If you invest 150,000 in expanding it into a gymnasium and spa, right now, after 5 years of time, your profits or your retained earnings will go up by 20,702 in real time. assuming that the cost of capital remains at 12% and other factors continue as assumed. If you don't get 82% of occupancy, there's a problem here. If you don't get the extra 5% of income from $260 to $262.5, that's a problem here. Right? It might eat away the profit. So this net present value is based a purely a financial assumption or based on numbers. It's purely a financial assumption and it's very subjective. It's not objective at all. It's very subjective. It's based on estimates, predictions and forecasts, which is likely the next part of the syllabus, sensitivity analysis. We got to see how sensitive variables are in making the net present value. So we'll do that later, but for the time being, the whole understanding of this investment decision is, yeah, if you go ahead replacing the library by installing a gymnasium and spa, after 5 years of time, you will have 20,702 or 20,686 in your profits accumulated, provided that the variables stay constant and your assumptions are valid. If these are going to change, this amount will also change. So on a purely financial perspective, as the net present value is positive, yes, you can go ahead with the project. Yes, you can invest in the gymnasium and spa. But remember, your writing and your assumptions should also talk about this. Yes, the variables should remain as it is, or else it becomes invalid again. This is F9 for information, and that is end of class. What is it done? Okay, fine. Very nice. No, that's not happening this time. You and your careless mistake will go into the sack. Right? So guys, this is it. This is how we start, and every day we'll be attacking on questions like this. We're building ourselves for the exam. We should be okay. Should be okay by the end of Feb, most probably. So tomorrow there is no training again, but day after tomorrow, yes. Are we okay? May I take your leave, madam, sir, everyone? Bye bye. Okay, be safe, yeah. I'll see you day after tomorrow. What is it? Bye, take care. Bye to all. Take care and be safe. I hope you understood 60% of whatever is being done. Okay, see you. Bye.